All right. Soundbooth leader 5 is starting. It's getting off to a bad start today. I was supposed to have Mr. Joel Frimpin on the show, and I failed miserably because of my technological lack of prowess. Sorry, everybody, for that. But he has agreed to come back. Maybe not next week, but the week after. He will be doing a stream with me that time. I'm probably going to have to update to a different, to a better streaming app, because I'm using OBS right now, which is like free shit. And as always, free shit is harder to use. More complicated tasks. Oh man.
How's that? Oh shit, that's way too loud. I forgot to do the mix, damn it! Okay, sorry guys! So Joel was supposed to be with us today. Why is my Twitch thing not working? Joel was supposed to be with us today, but he couldn't be. Because I messed up with the technology. I wasn't able to get Skype streaming properly with the sound and everything, so Joel has agreed to come back. Obviously he never came onto the show, but he will be with us, maybe not next week, but the week after, we'll see. I'll release something official on the Soundbooth Theater Live Facebook group and let you guys all know. I'm so sorry I didn't get this to work out properly. I really was excited to do this, but I just didn't prepare. So here we are. Another... Oh, finally I can see stuff on the Twitch chat. For some reason, it's having issues. It's like continuously loading. But, I don't know. You probably couldn't hear me earlier, but what I was saying earlier was that I have the free version of my streaming program, so I think I'm gonna have to upgrade to the paid version, which is like $500, but it'll probably be worth it so that I can actually get all this stuff squared away to where it's easy to have guests on. It's this program simply just too bare bones and not enough features to make things easier. But I still have plenty of requests to do. Still got a day's work ahead of me. So I hope you guys will stick around. I hope you guys will still bring other people and stuff. I don't know, it should still be a good show. I'm determined to make up for this. Yeah, $500, ouch, is right. Yes, OBS is what I'm using. And, oh, sorry guys, sorry anybody who's watching on Facebook, people are asking things on Twitch. If you're not on Twitch, and you're watching through Facebook or through YouTube, and you want to join the conversation, go to twitch.tv/fiatcelebrity. That's F-I-A-T, celebrity. And there you'll be able to talk to us. We'll be starting the show in another minute. We're just letting we're letting people trickle in before we get the show started. Got a few interesting things to read today anyway. And everybody loves large chests, so we at least have that for the show. I think that and the Overlord thing and I have maybe one extra surprise lit RPG to read for you guys. Oh, Sin's asking some deep questions here. So where'd you come up with the name Fiat Celebrity? Maybe I'll give you that history here after this starting screen goes away. I don't have control over that. It just kind of does what it wants to do, and then at its mercy, I start the show. Oh, see, just out of nowhere, decides, let's start. Okay. So the name Fiat Celebrity. The word fiat kind of is central to a lot of the things that I think about. The first association of the word that I've ever heard, before I even heard of the cars or anything, was fiat currency. I ran into that a while back in high school when I first started getting interested in economics. And fiat currency is the word to describe what our current currency is, what almost all currency is around the world, which is basically paper money that is worth what it's worth because the government says so. Fiat, that's like, so a fiat is a declaration. I actually named my band Fiat when I had one, and I don't know, the word just has this certain thing. It's always stuck in my head because it's like an entity such a, as powerful as the government can just say something and make it so. So I started just sticking that word on to lots of things that I associate with because it's kind of like branding for my band, but it's also just a little bit of social commentary, because a lot of people claim that they're things nowadays, and I think that being a celebrity is one of the things that maybe is starting to fall victim to the fiat phenomenon, where people on the internet can just like act like they're famous, and people kind of like catch on. They're like, oh, he acts like he's got his things together. He seems like a star. He's got this way of talking, and I think now more than ever, that's really easy to do. So it's just a little thumbing my nose at people like that, but at the same time embracing it. I don't know, it's weird and meta, but that's where I got it from. By declaration, a celebrity, because I say so. Just a bit of fun. Uh-oh. You guys are saying you're only hearing it in one ear because I have not downmixed to mono. How's that? That should be better, right? So, today on Soundbooth Theater Live. Again, I apologize. Joel Frumkin will not be joining us because I messed up the technology. I thought it would be much easier to incorporate a Google chat or a Skype into the stream, but apparently that doesn't work out easy. So I'm either going to have to update to a better software or do way more research online because, I don't know, I wouldn't have been able to hear him, and we were supposed to be playing off each other, like trading off roles, one of us narrating, the other one doing characters, trying to do like fun experiments like that, and that can't be done if I can't hear him in real time. So I could have had the show go where you could hear him, but I couldn't, and I would just have to like watch at the same time and see when he's done talking, go okay, and start, but it just wouldn't have worked out. So a couple weeks, probably not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, Joel and I will figure something out, and we'll give people a little more time. I only announced it officially on the Facebook page like 2 days before today anyway, and that was the wrong move to make. I should have been more on top of things about promotion anyway. So I think that's I guess maybe for the better at this point that I wasn't able to make it happen, because next time we'll probably be able to tell more people and make it more of a big deal, get more of his fans in to watch, and that would have made that, that could potentially make a really big request only. So anyway, let's get started here, and we're going to get started with a book called Illusional Reality by Karina Kantas. I'm trying to remember how long ago, like a week and a half ago, she requested this. It seems interesting. Looks like sort of maybe a urban fantasy romance type of thing. Romantic fantasy is how she describes it. And she also sent me some pronunciation guides for the weird words in here. Let me play those again real quick just to refresh myself.
Sweetes, Perteus, Omad.
Omad.
Sinx.
Hold on. Try that again.
Rikes,
where's that?
Omad.
Thea. I see Kizar. Sorry, just looking for these words that she, Rikes?
Rikes,
yeah. Ertius. Sounds like she's British. Sinx. Okay, that's one of them. There's one. Perteus. Okay. Gotcha. All right. I don't know. Is she British? Are you here? Are you here, Karina Kantas? Would you like British accents? I'm just gonna assume for now. What is going on? My chat keeps refreshing and stuff. I'm just gonna do British accents for now. Just for fun. And see how it goes. Thaya, I think Thaya's a female. All right, the rest, we'll wing it, we'll see. Illusional Reality by Karina Kantas.
Wow, that was amazing. I've never seen anything like it. You really do get caught up in it, do you not?
Thaya gasped. Omad and Alcazar laughed. Siren left to speak to a friend, and soon Omad made his excuses to leave.
If you will absolve my departure, my lady, I speculate that my fellow Tsinians desire to converse.
Thaya watched as Omad walked over to a group of Tsinians that were similar in dress. They patted him on his back as if in congratulations. She turned her attention back to Alcazar. She smiled at him, and their eyes locked, until Alcazar broke away.
Who do you surmise will be victorious? He asked.
He's asking Thaya. Okay.
I'm sure the Silver Knights will win. They seem to be the strongest of the two. You are more familiar with the game. Who do you think will win my favor?
Alcazar laughed.
Nay, my lady, I disagree with your outcome. The team colored red will triumph, for they are swifter.
Oh, I agree. The red dragons have more speed. Call it woman's intuition, if you will. Only I am certain the Silver Knights will win.
Alcazar threw back his head and laughed.
You possess strange expressions, Thaya. Although if we ruled our land on intuition, as you name it, we would have lost our land to Darthorn long ago.
Alcazar regretted his words as soon as they left his lips, although Thaya seemed unaffected by his comment.
So, a bet then, she cried. What will you give me if my team wins?
You retain the whole of Sinia at your feet. What could I possess that you would claim as your reward?
Thaya didn't reply. Leaning in closer, he lowered his voice.
More to the point, my lady. What could you offer me?
his eyes bored into her soul. Alas, regretfully, I will decline.
Why so?
Thaya asked. His eyes shone, as did his smile. I do not gamble, for I am fearful of the amount I could lose. He smiled again, only his eyes saddened and his grin faded. Pardon, my lady. Unfortunately, I am requested elsewhere. I hope you enjoy the remainder of the tournament. I look forward to concluding our conversation. He bowed and then left. To Thaya's annoyance, Siren met him.
What?
Siren met who? I think she means to Thaya's annoyance, Siren met her. To Thaya's annoyance, Siren met her. She took his arm and guided him to the other side of the arena, but not before glancing over her shoulder and giving Thaya a look of triumph. Thaya turned away, when what she should have done was smile and wave back. Why give Siren the satisfaction of knowing how uncomfortable she was at seeing them together? Oh, I see. Siren met, what's his face? That is inappropriate, phone. Alcazar, she met, okay. To Thaya's annoyance, Siren met him, met Alcazar. She took his arm and guided him to the other side of the arena, but not before glancing over his shoulder and giving Thaya a look of triumph. Okay, I see. Jealousy thing. Thaya couldn't concentrate on the final match. Even though she tried not to, she spent most of the game watching Siren and Alcazar. Her attention was finally awakened by the applause of the audience when a team scored a point. As it was now expected, she stood and clapped the scorer. Only it was without feeling or enthusiasm. Thaya couldn't turn her sight away from the pair. Siren made it obvious that she lay claim to Alcazar, clinging to his arm and whispering in his ear. However, Alcazar's attention was fixed on the game. He hardly acknowledged Siren's flirting. Kizar followed Thaya's gaze and felt pity for her mistress. It was clear she had feelings for Alcazar, only her union was prearranged, as was his. It seemed to Thaya that the final game was never ending when at last a gong rang out. The Silver Knights were victorious. It was her moment to shine. Omad took her by the arm and led her to the heart of the arena where the players waited for their princess. Other esteemed Sinians, including Alcazar, joined them. There was a hushed silence as the crowd awaited Thaya's word. She knew what she wanted to say, just not how to phrase it. To annoy Siren and prove she did have a claim on Alcazar, she called to him,
"Alcazar! A moment, if you will!"
Alcazar looked embarrassed to be called for counsel in front of his peers, but even so, he was soon by her side. She turned her back to the others and whispered to him,
"I wish to invite the winners for refreshments at the place where I dwell. However, I'm not sure how to ask them correctly."
Alcazar smiled. "Firstly, Princess, your home is named the Rikus, and 'tis a great honor to be invited there. Few have sighted the inside of our ruler's abode. This is well done. Secondly, as you are aware, we do not waste our duration with dates and times. So bid them to attend you in one trill moon. What a trill moon is will be explained in due course. Tis not the correct place for conversing."
"Thanks, Alcazar. I knew I could count on you."
He bowed and returned to his position. Thaya spoke to each of the players, asking for their names and chatting about the game. The council watched as their princess joked and laughed with her subjects. The invitation to the Rikus was received well. Applause filled the arena. Alcazar watched Thaya with interest. He thought her a fine princess, with the manners and beauty of a Ganti, yet she had brains and charms also. Kovon did not deserve her. Not one Sanx did. Once the presentation had ended, Thaya was directed to a marquee where an array of food was on display. The feast lay across 5 long wooden tables. The villagers had outdone themselves. There were sweetbreads, succulent meats, puddings, and even salad vegetables. Thaya wanted to thank Grenko, for she was sure he was responsible. She searched for him, and finally found him talking with Nymus and Athenia. Only before Thaya could approach, a ginger-headed Sinian blocked her path.
"Greetings, my lady!"
"Hello, Pertius."
"I hope you are favoring our humble gathering, and that the tournament was not too tedious for you."
"Not at all. It was very exciting. Although, I admit, it has been a long day, and I am feeling tired. If you will excuse me..."
Pertius paused before speaking again.
"I understand. 'Tis not my station to inquire. Only, I'm curious. I realize that no one has conversed with you thus far. I was wondering if you had received an awakening of your gift as yet."
"As I am sure you know, I begin my first lesson with Alcazar tomorrow. However, if you're asking whether or not I can make things move, then I am sorry to disappoint you. I was informed that a Ganti is supposed to possess powers, only I do not. You all have high expectations of me, and I do not want to let anyone down. Only, there you have it."
She turned to leave, but Pertius grabbed her arm.
"All your kinsmen expect is for you to fulfill the prophecy and unite Sinia and Senx in an alliance."
Thaya turned to face him.
"Senx?"
Pertius told Thaya about Senx and of their ruler, Darthorn, leaving no details out. He was thrilled to have such a captive audience. When at last his mouth became dry from speech, he stopped. Thaya stared at him, open-mouthed. Finally, she spoke.
"Why would you want to make an alliance with someone evil and dangerous? Are you not worried that Darthorn will destroy everything good about Sinia?"
Pertius proceeded to explain the oracles. Thaya listened, though her sight was open. Though her sight was upon the ugly, dark mountain which looked out of place beside the beauty of the forest. Though she could not see Darthorn's castle, she tried to visualize what it might look like. Pertius took a deep breath. He had talked so fast he was certain he had lost her somewhere.
"Okay,"
she said.
"I understand. If the oracles promised an alliance, and as you say, they are never wrong, I have to take your word. What I do not understand is why I am here. How am I supposed to be your prophesied savior?"
Prophesied or prophesied? I've always wondered about that one. Oh, Falcon 1678 looks like Jeffrey Falcon Logue of the Slime Dungeon, or the writer of the Slime Dungeon. He didn't come from a slime dungeon. But he's watching. I think I'll be getting to his request. He requested a portion of his book, he said he requested something, but I didn't see a link or anything. I'm thinking he just wants me to go with the sample that's on Amazon, but if not, I'll talk to him soon, but that'll be next week, so. Hi.
"You expect me to meet..."
Oh, sorry. Prophesied or prophesied, I can't... I think it's prophesied.
"How am I supposed to be your prophesied savior?"
"'Tis you who has been chosen to unite the alliance with Darthorn."
"You expect me to meet with this warlord and discuss peace with him? Are you mad? This has nothing to do with me. I know nothing of Tinia. This is your fight, not mine. Send Omad. He is the highest ranking. It is he who should speak with Darthorn, not me."
She calmed herself before continuing.
"Still, I believe 'tis a bad idea. I believe 'tis a bad idea. Is there not an alternative? Have you even thought about this?"
It was Pertius's turn to be shocked. He assumed Omad had spoken to her of the alliance.
"My lady, you misunderstand me. Has someone not disclosed why you were returned?"
"Certainly. I am to redeem you all."
Well, sarcastically.
"Certainly. I am to redeem you all."
Thaya said sarcastically. The conversation turned serious. It seemed she was, at last, going to find out why her life had been ruined. "'Tis the coming matrimony between yourself and Darthorn's son, Kovan, that will cement the alliance between the two lands." Thaya's face turned pale, and she could not move or find the words to speak. Alcazar noticed the change in Thaya's aura. He sensed their discussion was serious, both concerned and curious. He investigated. What? That's strange structuring there.
What? What? Thaya stuttered. What did you say?
The wedlock between Kovan and yourself. 'Tis agreed upon, Pertius answered, puzzled by her reaction.
It most certainly is not.
I think I can do that better.
It most certainly is not.
Her raised voice stopped the music and laughter. Even Alcazar froze to the spot. All were witness to her rage.
How dare you presume I would meet with Darthorn, let alone marry his son? Now you listen to me, and you listen good. You kidnapped me from my home, took me away from everything I hold dear, took my life away without my consent, and now you expect me to marry the last person I would ever consider as a husband. I would rather die.
Lightning struck overhead. Thaya turned to the crowd. Her sight fell on Alcazar. She felt betrayed by him.
I renounce my title. I never asked for any of this, and I want not. I want to go home, and I demand you return me.
Tears flowed down her face.
I cannot aid you. This is not my fight. I am sorry.
Then she fled from the astonished crowd. For one stunned moment, no one knew what to say or how to react. The murmurs began, and the council signaled Omad to go after her. Already, Alcazar was on her trail.
Oh, hey, what's up, Peppermint Butler? Lots of faces. Thanks for the faces, man. I appreciate faces.
Thaya ran to the forest, continuing until her strength could take her no further. She collapsed.
Why? I always have so much trouble with something ED, and then the next word starts with a D or a T.
Collapsed to the ground and wept.
Like, in speech, you don't really think about it. You just kind of, like, collapse to the ground. But if you're not paying attention, you realize you're getting rid of like some sound there. Collapse. It's like you get rid of the D when you're just talking. Collapse to the ground. It just kind of gets skipped over. But as a narrator, you really want to enunciate. So
she collapsed to the ground. She collapsed to the ground and wept.
Hard, but I did it that time.
The pursuers reached Thaya together. Omad was unsure of what to say. My lady, he stammered.
Go away, she cried. Leave me alone.
Princess, Alcazar gently called. Thaya looked up at him, her eyes red and sore.
You knew,
Thaya yelled,
and you did not tell me.
It was not my duty to tell you, nor was it my intention for you to be informed like this. It was wrong of Pertius to announce it. It was not the correct moment or place.
All of you have been planning my wedding before I even arrived in this cursed land, have you not?
You are just, my lady,
Omad answered. Sorry, I'm giving him a racist accent. It's just his name's Omad. I'm just going to run with it.
I have not awareness on what or how much Pertius has disclosed to you. Only 'tis written in the oracles. 'Tis your duty to aid your kinsmen.
Alcazar wished Omad would cease talking. He was not helping matters. Thaya wiped her tears.
I understand this. However, do you not think I should have been consulted before you arranged the rest of my life? Do I not have a say? If I really am the future queen of Sinia, what grants you the right to organize my future? Who gave you this authority?
there was not duration to linger, Omad explained. The threat of war is ever greater, and your prophecy to return seemed the key to our difficulties. We believe you will convey peace to our land.
Where'd it go? I looked up at what you guys were saying, and you distracted me, and I lost my place. It happens all the time.
Why marriage? She asked. Why can you not create an alliance without my involvement? If you are certain this is all that is needed.
Darthorn would not agree to this. It was his condition, Omad answered.
Oh, now I understand. Do you not comprehend what he is doing? Already he is ruling Sinia, and you are allowing him... Already he is ruling Sinia, and you are allowing him to command you. He is accustomed to having everything his own way. Well, not anymore. I refuse to marry Kovan, and my mind will not alter. However, I will try to aid you, as you deem it is my duty to do so. Now, leave me alone. Return to the council, and come up with another solution for peace, and I will attempt to do the same.
Thaya turned away from them. Omad bowed and departed, while Alcazar dropped to the ground beside her. He played with the wood chipping, then grabbed a handful of dirt and placed it in Thaya's hand.
This is Sinia. Whether you accept this or not, 'tis your home, your land. You are part of it, and it is part of you. It has, and always will be. Your kinsmen depend on you, Thaya. We cannot fight Darthorn. We barely have enough power to resist him, and he is gaining strength. There is no alternative. I never wanted this, she cried. I feel like I'm living a nightmare I cannot wake from. It is getting darker, and I am drifting deeper. I cannot see the light anymore, Alcazar. I do not feel like myself, and that scares me.
Your looks and personality are changing to that of a Ganti. Soon your speech and soul will become Sinian.
I do not want to alter. I feel suffocated, choked by the pressure upon me.
Unable to control her grief any longer, Thaya broke down again. Alcazar felt pity for her. He understood the emotions she was experiencing and wanted to console her, tell her everything would be okay. Only he would not lie. A perilous destiny lay before her. He could not change that. But, if it were possible, he would try to ease the blow. With that thought in mind, he pulled her close. Okay, so... Woman needs to marry some asshole in order to save a whole race of people. That's, I'm trying to think of another story that sounds like. But it was a problem. It's a problem with a lot of cultures where they have arranged marriages, right? Where, you know, you have a woman whose free will is under threat because, really, if she doesn't marry this guy, it's gonna have horrible implications to the culture around her. So it's like, what do you do? I like the setup. So, Karina, thank you so much for requesting Illusional Reality. This is available on Amazon if you liked that sample. So go check it out. And what do we got next? All right. So, next, I'm going to do a request from Don Chapman. Why is it taking me to Facebook? That's not what I wanted. Follow link? Okay, Railroad, here we go. All right, so I've done a couple SBTLs with Dawn's stuff before. It was a short story that she had. It seemed like it was kind of setting up the rest of her books, setting up, you know, these relationships. It was a prequel, so it was like trying to tell you how this dude Oktav,
How he came into his power. I can't remember exactly what the new rank was that he attained, but he attained it because the king died, and the king was like, the king is the prince's father, obviously, but Oktav and the prince are like good friends, so it was almost like a father figure died for Oktav. But because of his death, he was able. The prince became the king, I think, and then Oktav got the promotion. So he's a bigger deal now, and it looks like she's got several short stories, sort of prequeling the series that she started. Oh, let me put up her. This is the image of her audiobook on Audible. The Secret King Lethau, I believe, is how you pronounce it. She's got a whole pronunciation system that, if I mess it up this time, I'm sorry. I forgot to look back at it. I kind of like grabbed extra stuff because I knew I couldn't do those two books that Joel was going to be featured on. Those were his projects, and I wanted to do that with him. So those are two projects that I had to ditch, and now I had to drag in a couple more. I didn't re-look at the pronunciation, so if I murder any of those during this reading, I'm sorry. But so far, we've met Oktav. He seems like a cool guy. He's gotten promoted, and this scene starts off with him. Now, this short story is on Royal Road Legends. I don't know how much of Don Chapman's stuff is on Royal Road Legends, but it looks like she uses it as much as you guys. Yeah, that's where this is from, and the short story is called The Summit. Tales from the Secret King, The Summit. The immense room lay before Oktav. It was like nothing he'd ever seen. Scanning quickly, he imagined at least 100 of their Ross fighters would fit within its confinements. It was decked out like a lavish temple, decorated with glimmering ornaments and quilted banners. Tables from an over-engineered classroom lined surfaces left to right, and then there was the center table, carved with an ancient Lacrian dialect even he couldn't understand. Lacrian? Oh yeah, A is always supposed to be soft. I never remember how to talk about pronunciation. Soft A is ah, right? Right? Oktav had seen many rooms inside the royal palace, some filled with relics that inspired and instilled a fear within, but nothing like this one room. So what was it that had him running scared?
Not the room. More like my promotion.
This new job gave him an all-access pass, and, with that, the power to organize meetings, even meetings like this, of each royal house in the sector. Yes, he, Oktav, had called a meeting of the three. Just like any promotion, though, he would not let it faze him. Oktav touched the back of a chair, running his hand down the intricate carving. It shone with runes and images that depicted days of glory past.
It's funny, the word shone, I don't know. In American accent, it's shone. But in British accent, it's shone. And sometimes right after I'm done narrating in British, I like mispronounce certain things like this.
This room alone had seen countless gatherings. The most powerful Aeonese.
I think this is one of those contexts where you use the long A.
The most powerful Aeonese having made decisions and negotiations echoing across many
Let me just start over that whole paragraph. I'm sure you're lost now.
Oktav touched the back of a chair, running his hand down the intricate carving. It shone with runes and images that depicted days of glory past. This room alone had seen countless gatherings, the most powerful Aeonese having made decisions and negotiations echoing across many generations. Oktav kept close to the robed senior aide, as they moved from the summit's main room down a corridor. Gavinu took him to a display room where he started to point out various items of import and significance while they waited for the house's arrival. Nothing was sticking. It had been less than a day since King Valor's death, and there was a deep, invisible wound somewhere inside of him where the king's presence had been torn away. Everything was a blur, including the stuffy old man's name. Was it Yanni? Yemu? Still, Oktav did his best to pretend he was absorbing at least a little of the man's insistent history lesson. The robed senior aide. So I'm gonna assume he's got a weak old voice.
"We'll chime twice upon the arrival of a royal relative, but also twice on the arrival of the great house leader. If it is a second or a relative of the king past the first degree, it will only chime once. All other dignitaries are simply announced by the host, but the bell of Ari is not rung."
He glanced at Oktav.
"Have you any questions?"
"The chime. Twice. Once. None. I get it. I think."
"And this?"
This is Gavino still. Yeah, Gavino is the dude.
"And this. This is the banner of Sivdalna. It was given to the then-king Kelvinar as tribute for allowing House Sunaya to move into the Northwest Mountains and have ownership of the riches within. As it was the start of the Sunaya legacy as the builders of our people, it is only to be donned if the royal house is approving matters regarding buildings or other construction larger than a dwelling of at least 500 individuals."
500 or more, he stammered.
Oktav didn't know if there was some sort of innate power in the room, but there was a palpable pressure on his mind as he passed the massive crest of the royal house, Nyakrex.
Nyakrex? Yep.
How could he take his meeting of the three royal houses, knowing everything rested on it, Just yesterday, he was a commander whose sole purpose was to protect those under him. Now he was Einarin of the king. It felt like the weight of the world rested on his shoulders, though in this case, it actually did. His actions here and now would be looked upon for generations. Without this meeting of the three houses, Kendro wouldn't stand a chance after his anointing. Although Oktav wasn't quite sure what that was, Kendro had instructed him, "You must lead the summit while I am away. After tonight, I will or I will not be your king." Oktav had agreed, though he was terrified of speaking in front of the others. He would complete this task for his friend and king. Looking to Gavinu now, he tried to smile.
"So, what do I do? As the Einarin, do I get a special coat or something?"
The old man stopped and slowly turned to him as a resounding chime assaulted their ears.
"Your predecessor, Einarin Demel, was the epitome of the Einarin. He spent decades building alliances and connections between the houses. He was both a masterful diplomat and a statesman in his own right. He was the mastermind behind the peace we enjoyed for almost three generations."
The old man's eyes failed to hide their scorn.
He did not require a magic wand or some sort of fancy dress to establish his authority over the houses. Should you require one, I'm sure our artisans could arrange some sort of harness or embellishment to make yourself known.
Oktav tried to ignore the tone Gavinu used. He felt so vulnerable, fearing for each and every choice he was about to make, in case they turned out to be mistakes.
So, why me? Why not someone else?
The aged glare only deepened.
You, it seems, are all that is left.
The insult hung in the air for several steps. Oktav felt it, but wasn't prepared to listen. Kendro, his closest friend, had bestowed upon him the title of Einarin, not only because he was his best friend, but because he believed in him. Despite his trepidation, Oktav summoned the confidence of his king and believed. Then he asked that most pertinent question.
You don't think I can handle this, do you?
With all due respect, no. No, I do not think you can handle this or any other matter that will soon cross your fleeting awareness.
Gavinu's wrinkled hands folded before him.
Our aspiring king has placed his trust in you, but it is not in the royal decree of arbitration that the aides of the crown need to do the same. If I may be so bold, Einarin Oktav, I think you are scarcely capable of dressing yourself, much less handling negotiations of planetary importance.
The old man's eyes did not flinch from Oktav's intensity.
Thank you for your honesty.
Oktav's croax rose within, yet Gavinu's stare didn't falter. As that sickening reason turned in Oktav's stomach, he met Gavinu's stony glower, and, immediately, he felt the resolve of the man pressing down on him, his croax tempering him. Oktav allowed his croax to surface, its green hues and energy shimmered around the room. Gavinu finally flinched, his eyes lowered.
Aide Gavinu, I apologize if I seem a bit out of sorts at the moment, but you will remember our king has passed on. His body is just on the other side of the palace complex, hardly cold. Are you not in the least bit affected? How can you be so apathetic?
Do not mistake focus for apathy, Einarin.
Okay, he snaps that, so let me try that again.
Do not mistake focus for apathy, Einarin.
Gavinu snapped.
I, like all of us, am deeply saddened by the passing of King Valor. I served at his side longer than you've been alive. I will mourn him when the time allows, but I have seen enough seasons to know the true strength of our people is not our monarch, but our traditions.
What's funny about this voice is I never ever use it without the British accent. So it's like this actor is a British actor. It sounds like a British actor doing a bad American accent when I read as him. It's weird.
Gavinu gestured to the room around him.
It is those traditions that allow us to hold a summit the day after the passing of our king. It is those traditions that allow you to attempt to hold our people together with this meeting. And it is those traditions that will ensure the future of the world. Perhaps, in your barracks, you may take time to mourn the passing of your leaders, but in these halls, the world stops for no individual.
Oktav knew there was no pleasing this man now. Not yet. There was time, however, and this was a challenge he would take in his stride. Taking a deep breath, Oktav held up his hands.
I understand. You don't like me. I'm not asking you to like me, but I need your help. I'm a soldier. You are the senior aide. You've seen more negotiations in this room than any king or house leader, right?
Oktav waited while he watched the older man's loyalty waver.
What?
His loyalty? Oktav waited while he watched the older man's loyalty waver. So he continued,
You've been here longer than anyone with some fancy title or shiny headpiece. You're the smartest person in this room. And even you said, King Valor didn't always listen to your counsel.
Gavinu's eyes darted left and right.
There have been some I advised differently. I am not King Valor, and I am not Einarin Demil.
Oktav placed a hand on the older man's shoulder.
My name is Oktav Broki, and I am asking for your counsel.
For the first time, Oktav saw the old man really falter.
Einarin, I don't believe there is time. Gavinu, yes, there is. In a matter of days, I'm going to be hosting a summit that might decide the fate of our entire people. And while I have yet to earn your confidence, I'm giving you mine.
He held the man's gaze, feeling his glower soften.
Senior aide, Gavinu, you see the position I'm in. What advice would you give me about to face the house leaders on behalf of our king?
Another chime resounded about them, and Oktav's Croax flickered dark emerald in response. Even if he didn't want to show his nerves, he knew they were clear to the man before him. Gavinu's eyes met his, and he spoke clearly.
Because you consulted me on this matter.
Gavinu took a slow breath.
I would advise you to refrain from appealing to authority. The houses are a stubborn bunch. If you are too, in any way, change their minds, you will need to appeal to them as equals, not as their betters.
He turned away for a moment, then turned back.
King Valor did not listen to me when I told him this. He sought to command, not lead. And while I can't take full credit, I believe Ori would have agreed with me in the matter. And perhaps this summit would have been unnecessary.
A smile crossed Oktav's lips.
Gavinu, you may have just saved our people.
And that is, I think, there's probably a few chapters to this short story, but I think we'll stop there. Thanks again, Don, for another request. This series is turning out to sound like a lot of political intrigue, a lot of interesting relationships between all the characters, a lot of conflict. I'm having fun with it. It's getting better and better as we keep going, so hope you liked it, Don. Thanks again for requesting. Sin says, what have you named that actor? I think she's referring to the actor I was using to play Gavinu. And I named him Silas because I developed that voice for Silas from His Dark Empire by M.R. Forbes.
Silas Morningstar. Kind of a blend between Ian McKellen and, who's the Irishman from Taken? I don't remember his name. The voice sounds more like him, but the accent and the delivery sounds more like Ian McKellen.
All right, let's see. All right, next we're going to do a lit RPG. It's called Overlord. Liam Neeson, that's the guy. Let me open this up while I go get this sample here. Where's the sample? Look inside. Let's do it. I want to look inside. Oh, maybe I can download a sample. Close that. Thank you. Send a free sample. There we go. No, not second fire. I'm going to go back. I just got a new Kindle Fire, by the way.
Well, come on now. There we go. Fourth fire. It's not... It's my... No, not, no. God damn it. Nope, nope. Touch screens. Would you behave yourself, please? No. God damn it. Here we go. All right. So this one's called Overlord. And I think this is a Japanese translation. But instead of just getting, yes, Liam Neeson is Irish. But instead of it just being on some random, not random, but some fan site where people try and do the translation themselves or through a program or whatever, this is actually available on Amazon. So, maybe the translation's better. I don't know. We will see. But if I'm not mistaken, this one's like, this one is, Overlord is kind of, oh yeah, he sent me a link to it, but it's just not, I'd rather use the Mobi version. It's just much more convenient for me. So that's why I downloaded the free sample from Amazon. And it starts with the prologue. Should I skip the prologue or go straight to chapter one? Looks like I should just stay on... I should just do prologue in chapter one. Because it's not long enough otherwise. So this one's a Japanese... Oh, wow. Okay, so this one's a Japanese translation. And Danny's telling me that Overlord got an anime adaptation. So, I mean, this one's pretty popular. So let's give it a shot. Ooh, first sentence. Reads like a bad translation. This is going to be fun. The prologue is... Looks like 4 or 5 pages. And so is the first chapter, so. So yeah, oh, and I forgot to say who the author was. Sorry about that. This is Overlord by Kugane Maruyama. Kugane Maruyama. And I'll change the do-do-do-do-do. Look at that cover. It's kind of low res. But it's still a mess, no matter... Like, what is going on there? Is that a dude? Is... Like... Hold on, let me... navigate my finger. Is that a dude? Right over here. Is that a dude? I can't... It looks like a rib cage and like a cape. And then down here, is that like 4 dudes or is that one big dude? This is a mess. I can't make out this picture. Prologue. Before one girl and another even younger one stood a figure. Before one girl and another even younger one stood a figure in full plate armor brandishing a sword. The blade swung, sparkling in the sunlight, as if to say that taking their lives in a single stroke would be an act of mercy. The girl shut her eyes. She didn't want to be biting her lower lip. She just had no choice but to accept what was about to happen. If she had even a little power, she probably would have been able to shove the figure away and escape. But she was powerless. And so there was only one ending. She would die. The blade came down. The pain still hadn't come. She unscrunched her eyes. The first thing she saw was the sword, stopped mid-swing. The next was the figure holding the sword. The knight was practically frozen, looking at something off to her side.
His unprotected stance manifested his internal shock. The girl turned to follow his line of sight and saw despair. It was darkness, a patch of raven black, ultra-thin but so deep it seemed as if it went on forever. It was an oval rising up out of the ground, its bottom half cut off. It was a curious sight, but at the same time, it made her feel indescribably uneasy.
A door?
Was what came to mind when she looked at it. A heartbeat later, she would be proven correct. Something glided out of the darkness, and when she saw it, it was...
Ah!
A dry shriek escaped her lips. A human would have no chance against this being... A human would have no chance against this being. Hazy red light flickered flame-like in the vacant orbs of a bleached white skull. I think it's this thing, maybe. This thing. I think it's that thing. Hazy red light flickered flame-like in the vacant orbs of a bleached white skull. The gaze was trained unfeelingly on the girls as if they were live prey. Skinless, fleshless hands, both sublime and terrible, clutched a staff so gorgeous it seemed to be the concentration of all the world's beauty. It was as if death had donned an intricately ornamented raven-black robe and been born into this world from another along with the darkness. The air instantly froze. At the entrance of the absolute, even time seemed to stop. As though her soul had been taken, the girl forgot to breathe. With no sense of time, inhaling was difficult, and she nauseously gulped for air.
A messenger from beyond has come to lure us away.
But that didn't seem right. The night behind them had frozen as well. She heard an exhalation that could not even be called a scream, but whether it had been her trembling little sister, or the knight with the sword before them, she didn't know. Death's fingers, of which only the bones, picked clean, were left, stretched out slowly and then violently snatched at, not the girls, but the knight. She wanted to look away, but she was too scared. She had the feeling that if she looked away, the monster would transform into something even more horrible. What is it? Something says grasp heart. Okay, it's not clear what is saying this, but I think it's the shape. I think it's the death thing.
Grasp heart.
Death incarnate made a clenching motion, and metal clanged noisily next to the girl. She was scared to take her eyes off death, but she lost to the tiny bit of curiosity still dwelling inside her, and looked at the knight lying face down on the ground. He wasn't moving. He was dead. Yes, dead. The danger threatening to take her life had evaporated in a laughably simple way, but she couldn't celebrate. Death had only assumed a more concentrated form. Sensing the fear in her gaze with its entire body, death moved toward her. The darkness that had been contained within her field of vision began to expand.
It's going to swallow us up.
She hugged her sister close. The idea of running away didn't even occur to her anymore. If her opponent had been a human, she might have been able to act on the faint hope of maybe, but the being before her dashed that hope as if it were nothing.
Please let it not hurt, at least.
That was the most she could hope for now. Her little sister clung to her waist, shaking with fear. She wanted to save her, but she couldn't. All she could do was apologize for her powerlessness and pray that they would die together so she wouldn't be lonely. And then... I wish I could show you this picture. It's nice illustrations in this ebook. Well, sort of. It's kind of muddy like this one is. I guess, you know, obviously the cover art is the same as the illustrations inside, stylistic-wise. But there's less going on in this picture, and it actually looks nice. Oh, okay. Someone's explaining what the got heart thing was, or what is it? Grasp heart? Apparently it's a spell, and it was the main character casting it. So, is the girl that was just in that the main character? Or is it like somebody else who popped in and like tried to rescue her? I don't know. Chapter 1. In the year 2138, there exists something called a DMMORPG. This stands for Dive Massively Multiplayer Online Role-Playing Game. While connected via an intracranial nanocomputer network called a neuro-nano interface, which combines the best of cyber and nanotechnology, players experience physical sensations as if they were really inhabiting an imaginary world. In other words, you play as if you're actually in the world of the game. And among all the various DMMORPGs that had been developed, one stood above the rest. Yggdrasil. Okay, so...
Lau?
There's these other dogs. My neighbors have these dogs. My neighbors are dicks. Okay? They have these dogs that are aggressive, and they, like, bark like they want to murder my dog when they're on the other side of the fence. Well, at first it was just, like, annoying. But now, whenever I let my dog out, I have to make sure to watch her. Because their dog, their big boxer dog, will literally jump over the fence and attack my dog. And now whenever it's happened several times, so now whenever their dogs come outside, they try to provoke my dog, even though she's in my house. So they're like literally barking at my back door, trying to provoke her. And she goes on she has a fit. Ugh. Okay. And among all the various DMMORPGs that had been developed, one stood above the rest. Yggdrasil. It had been released 12 years earlier. You know what? I've said this word so many times, but I think I have just Yggdrasil. Yeah, that's the way it's pronounced. Okay. It had been released 12 years earlier, in 2126, by a Japanese developer who had been waiting for just the right moment. Compared to other DMMORPGs at the time, Yggdrasil gave players an incredible amount of freedom. For example, consider the class system, a fundamental element of character customization. Counting the advanced classes as well as the base ones, there were well over 2,000. Since each class had only 15 levels, players could have 7 or more classes by the time they hit the overall level cap of 100. As long as they met the basic requirements, they could dabble as they pleased, Though it would be inefficient, a player could acquire 100 classes at level 1 if they wanted to. In other words, the system was such that, unless they were deliberately created that way, no two characters would ever be the same. Then, by using the Creator's Toolkit, sold separately, players could edit the appearance of their weapons and armor, as well as the advanced settings of their in-game residences. The environment awaiting players who ventured into this world was enormous. In fact, there were 9 worlds, Asgard, Alfheim, Vanaheim, Nidavellir, Midgard, Jotunheim, Niflheim, Helheim, and Muspelheim. Okay, so these are all like, like Viking Norse names, and some of them I don't remember ever seeing before. A vast world, a staggering number of classes, and graphics that could be tweaked to one's heart's content. It was precisely the amount of customization that poured nitroglycerin onto the Japanese creative spirit and led to the game's explosive popularity. It got to the point where in Japan the word DMMORPG was practically synonymous with Yggdrasil. But that was all in the past now. This all reminds me very much of Secret of the Old One so far. In the center of the room, a gigantic circular table shone. In the center of the room, a gigantic circular table shone with an obsidian gleam. Around it were 41 magnificent seats. Most of them, however, were empty. Once, all the seats had been filled, but now only two figures remained. One wore an extravagant raven black academic robe with purple and gold trim. The collar was perhaps a bit over-embellished, but strangely, it suited the wearer. The bare head of the figure in question had neither skin nor flesh, just bone. Reddish-black flames burned in his gaping eye sockets, and something like a black halo shone behind him. The other one wasn't human either. More of an amorphous black blob, almost like coal tar. His constantly shifting surface meant that he had no fixed shape. The former was an elder lich, an undead being that was what remained of a caster who had pursued magic ability to its extreme, and the most elite type, an overlord. The latter was an elder black ooze, which was a slime race that had some of the most powerful acid abilities in the game. Oh, I see. Both races occasionally appeared as monsters in the most difficult dungeons. The various types of overlords used the highest level evil magic, while the elder black ooze had the ability to corrode weapons and armor, so both were famously hated. But these two weren't monsters. They were players. The races players could choose from in Yggdrasil were split into three main categories: basic humanoid races, humans, dwarves, elves, and so on. Subhuman races, who weren't pretty but performed better than humanoids, goblins, orcs, ogres, etc., and grotesques, who had monster powers and got more ability points than other races but were penalized in other ways. Including all the elite races, there was a total of 700 at the user's disposal. Naturally, overlords and elder black oozes were two of the elite grotesque races that players could become. The overlord spoke without moving his mouth, even for what had once been the pinnacle of DMMORPGs, it had still been impossible to animate expressions to align with conversation. Okay, this is gonna be hard. I'm gonna go with the overlord voice that I used earlier.
It's been a really long time, hero. Even though it's the last day Yggdrasil's servers are open, I didn't think you would actually come.
For real? Long time no see, Momonga.
Another adult male voice answered, but compared to the first, it sounded pretty lifeless.
It's been since you changed jobs IRL, so...
How long was that? 2 years?
Yeah, about that. Geez, it's been that long. Damn. My sense of time is messed up from working so much overtime.
Sounds rough. Are you doing okay?
My health? It's pretty much in tatters. Not doctor visit level, but pretty close. I really want to just run away from it all. But I gotta eat, so I'm working my ass off and getting whipped like a slave.
Yikes.
The Overlord Momonga leaned back to exaggerate his wince. This conversation was kind of killing the mood.
And that's it. Ah, that's it from the sample. Hold on. Someone, I think Danny gave me a link that maybe I can... maybe I can continue a little bit. Open browser. I'll be looking this way, though, so don't freak out. Chapter 1, here we go. Oh, and this is a different translation as well. Oh, man, this is going to be terrible. I can't do this. I have to line it up. Yikes. Okay.
Really, it's unbearable.
Now, hold on a second. I'm kind of confused as to who's Momonga. Okay, yeah, Momonga's the lich. Okay.
Really, it's unbearable.
Miro Miro's... Miro Miro? Okay, so it was Hiro Hiro, Hero Hero, I guess, in Japanese. Hero Hero was his name before, but in this translation, it's Mero Mero. So I'm just gonna, for simplicity's sake, just follow what's there.
Mero, Mero Mero's gloomy voice, laden with an incredible sense of reality, flew towards Momonga as if to inflict a follow-up strike. His complaint in regards to work in the real world accelerated further. Stories about impudent subordinates, plans that were completely altered overnight, criticism from his superior for failing to meet his quota, days pulling all-nighters due to shitloads of work, abnormal weight increase from his ruined biorhythm, the growing number of drugs with each passing day. Eventually, the conversation turned one-sided as Mero Mero's gripe burst out like a broken dam. There are a lot of people who avoid talking about reality in the virtual world. The feeling of not wanting to drag the real world into the virtual world was understandable. However, the two people here did not think that way. The guild, a team formed, organized, and operated by an assembly of players that they belonged to, Eins Uhl Gaun, had two rules for joining. First, you have to be a member of society. Secondly, you had to be a heteromorphic race. Due to the nature of the guild, there were many cases where complaints about work in real life became the topic, and this was accepted by the guild members. It could be said the conversation these two were having was an everyday scene in Eins Uhl Gaun. After a good amount of time had passed, the words of grievance from Mero Mero's mouth came to a halt.
I'm sorry for my endless complaining. I don't get much chance to vent on the other side.
Mero Mero wiggled what appeared to be its head, as if to bow. In response to this, Momonga quickly replied,
It's okay, Mero Mero-sama. I was the one who asked you to come, even though you were exhausted.
Compared to earlier, a faint laughter with a bit more vigor was heard from Mero Mero.
Thank you very much. Momonga-sama. I'm glad that I logged in and got to meet up.
I'm glad to hear you say that.
But I'm afraid it's about time for me to...
Meromero's tentacle moved in the air as if it was touching something. He was operating his console.
Ah, you're right. It's gotten very late.
I'm sorry, Momonga-sama.
Momonga sighed softly to conceal the emotions that had risen inside him.
I see. That's a shame. Honestly, fun times fly by so fast.
I really want to be with you until the end, but I'm exhausted.
You must be worn out. Please, do log out and get some rest.
I'm really sorry, Guildmaster. What will you do?
I'm planning to stay online until I'm disconnected when the service ends. There's still time. Who knows, another person might show up.
Is that so? Frankly, I didn't expect this place to still exist.
Okay, this is way too long, though. This chapter is huge. But I kind of wanted to just keep on going with that conversation because it's fucking funny. Like, I was doing these ridiculous voices and then, oh yeah, they're about to talk like normal people. Alright, so that's Overlord. I'm not sure where it's going. That opening scene was very dramatic, but I guess it's something that's happening in the game. So, and it's something that the main character is doing, like he's being evil or something. So I think this approach is maybe interesting. I think that using these two, like, opening the first chapter with these two monstrous entities, of course, I did the voices, so I don't even know if that's what they were supposed to sound like, but these two monstrous entities talking about problems at work, you know. So that's kind of cool. I might do another request of this if someone requests some more. So, we will see. Thank you. Who was it that requested that? Sorry, guys. Damn, Facebook, why do you take so long for everything? All right. Come on. Where is it? Ihab Lachir. Lachir or Lachir? I'm not sure. So, yes, thank you for requesting Ihab, and hopefully you'll be requesting some more in the future. All right, on to the next request. I think we will go with Eternal. Okay, this is Eternal Chronicles, Vampire, by the Chronicler. Now, I didn't grab the cover for this one, so sorry about that. I didn't give myself enough time, because I was kind of freaking out trying to get Joel's thing to work, and just couldn't, so... Alright, so Eternal Chronicles, Vampire. Here's the synopsis. In a long-forgotten time, when snow covered everything, the eye could see... Okay, pay attention to commas, dude. That's me. I'm talking to myself, not the author. He did fine. In a long-forgotten time, when snow covered everything the eye could see, there was a tribe of hard-willed people with a young boy. However, one day, tragedy struck the tribe, and they had to run away, only to get trapped in a cave. Okay. And then he's got, like, then he breaks the fourth wall and starts talking about how he didn't know how to write the synopsis. So, that's what we got. I don't know what's going on with this book, but we'll see. Eternal Chronicles, Vampire by the Chronicler. And I believe it was the author who requested it. Chapter 1.
In the darkness of a frozen tundra, there was a flickering light coming from a large bonfire. Surrounding the bonfire, there were dozens of little huts built from bones and hides. The bones were large, much larger than the groups of humans surrounding the campfire, and the hides were of various shapes and colors, from white to dark brown. It truly looked like they built it from whatever they could find. After all, in such frozen lands where the snow reached beyond your eye's horizon, you would rarely find any wood at all. Everything was covered in frozen ice. But somehow, even though everything was so cold and difficult, these people surrounding the bonfire all remained cheerful and energetic. After all, they never knew anything different. This wasn't just some cold winter. It was the Ice Age. The world was in a perpetuum of winter. They called it the season of never-ending snow. However, the concept of seasons was mysterious to them. All they knew of it were legends of a long time past. All they knew of it were legends of a time long past, where the heat from a bonfire would envelop the entire world, where the light of day would be long-lasting, and where the snow would melt. However, this was all passed down through the word of mouth. They had never seen it, nor had their parents, or grandparents, or even their grandparents' grandparents. No one believed that such a world was possible.
Oh, wait. Sorry, guys. I forgot to bring the chat back. Done. Oh, the Chronicler's here.
This wasn't okay. No one believed that such a world was possible. All it was just a story, to tell children before they went to sleep. Life was hard, but they still fought for survival, and this very night they celebrated, for their men had successfully downed a mammoth. Whenever they managed to hunt a mammoth, it would be great news for the tribe. It would allow the tribe food for weeks, and the bones were great for constructing huts. The shamans also greatly valued their tusks. They were very useful in rituals, and the powder made from it could be used as medicine, or so they believed. Amongst all these people, there was one young boy, especially excited. He had dark brown hair, almost black, and was about 10 years old. He looked on in amazement at the carcass of the large woolly mammoth as the men were cutting it up with their crude bone knives. On his side was a large man, also adorned with dark brown hair, but accompanied with a large beard, like most of the men had. The man and boy both shared brown eyes, just like everyone else in the tribe. As a matter of fact, they had never seen anyone with differently colored eyes, so they didn't think it was possible for humans to have other colors. And at the time, it wasn't. The large man with brown hair, beard, and eye combo, too, looked proudly at the mammoth carcass. He was the chieftain of the clan, and the young boy next to him was his son. His wife was with the other women, preparing dinner. Tonight, they would have a feast.
"What a wonderful catch," the large man said with a deep, loud voice. "In a few dozen moons, then you too shall join in the hunt, Ulfvalder.
I'm going to just do a Scottish accent for this guy. Just that word just kind of made me want to do one.
"What a wonderful catch. In a few dozen moons, then you too shall join in the hunt, Ulfvalder. Until then, you just have to practice diligently in throwing your spears and shooting your arrows and helping the gatherers."
No.
"In a few dozen moons, then you too shall join in the hunt, Ulfvalder. Until then, you just have to practice diligently in throwing your spears and shooting your arrows and helping the gatherers. I am sure that you will grow up to be an amazing hunter, and one day you shall be the next chief. You are not like the others. You must work hard for the sake of our tribe."
The large chieftain continued. The young boy, named Ulfvalder, looked at his father and said,
"Yes, father, I am sure that I will become the greatest hunter of the tribe and lead our tribes to greatness.
Ulfaldr looked very determined, and he had always looked forward to the day when he could join the hunt. He looked greatly up to his father, who was named Skeg. Humorously enough, Skeg meant beard, which attributed to his great beard. Some even said that he was born with his great beard, which is why he was named as such. This, of course, wasn't true. As for Ulfaldr, it meant wolf-wolf. It, too, was pretty humorous, but people rarely thought that much about the meaning of names. Usually, people just called him Ulf or Valdr. If anything, the name made it even harder for him, as the wolf was a great hunter, and his name had two wolves in it. He was determined to work hard. He had to be. From the day he was born, he had always been told that he would be the next chieftain. There was no small amount of pressure on him. Skeg also greatly cared for his son. He was the only son he had, so he was his only heir. It wasn't that he never had any other children. They just never survived. Most children that were born wouldn't survive the harsh climate. There were even some women who never had a single child survive more than a few years. However, by the time the child was as old as Ulfaldr, there was a great chance for them to grow up. Skeg doubted whether he'd ever have another child survive the years. After giving his speech to his son, Skeg finally decided to go and help the others with the workload of the mammoth. He took out a knife, made from white yellowish bone, and started cutting. Ulfaldr, too, went over to try and help, but there wasn't much he was able to do. He just carried the meat to their storage pit and fetched things that the adults needed, together with the few other children. Later, Ulfaldr made his way over to the bright fire, where his mother was at. They were busily cooking meat over the open fire. A delicious fragrance went over the frozen campsite and made everyone even hungrier, especially the men. When they went on long hunting trips, food would always be a shortage, as vegetation was very rare, and there was a limit to how much they could carry. They were largely bound to hunting small game for their meals. Where's their comma there? So they were naturally very hungry after the several-day-long trip. These parts sadly didn't have many animals, so they often went hungry. They rarely found any rabbits or the like. It was mostly just predators. From time to time, someone would get fed up with it and leave the tribe and search for better places, but they never came back. Everyone believed them dead. Ulfaldr's mother saw him coming running towards her. Ulfaldr's mother saw him come running towards her and welcomed him with open arms.
"Of kind, my dear, come help us a bit,"
his mother, Rafarta, said with a light-hearted voice. Rafarta was Ulfaldr's mother, but she was not from his tribe, from this tribe. She had been taken from another tribe about 11 years ago, in a raid, which was the norm. People often took mates from neighboring tribes, be it by aggression or agreement. In this case, it had been aggression, as there had been some grievances between the two tribes. However, those grievances were long forgotten, and both tribes minded their own business these days. Tribes couldn't afford to hold prolonged grudges. However, from that fight many years ago, young Rafarta had been taken, and the chieftain quickly fell for her. Rafarta also fell back for him, as time passed, and Ulfaldr was born. Rafarta was a very beautiful woman in her 20s. She, too, had dark hair with brown-colored eyes. Oh, okay. Ulfkind. We're going for German pronunciations here. And thus the moons quickly passed, and Ulfaldr grew taller and older. On his 15th year, he had gone out with his father and the others for his first hunt. It would be a several-day trip, as they were going to go a bit away from the tribe in hopes of finding some big game. If they were lucky, they might find a mammoth or a giant elk, or if they weren't, they could come upon wolves, or even worse, a saber cat. If that happened, they might lose a few men, which would be very bad. but the chances of that happening were low. Saber cats were usually alone and wouldn't approach a large group of humans, and the same could be said about the wolves. Except that wolves were in packs. As they walked, it was dark from all the clouds covering the sky. It was cold, as always, as they trod through the ice and snow. It was very chilly. You could feel the cold to the bones. You could feel the cold to the bones. It was not rare for one to get frostbite. A lot of people missed a toe, or even... A lot of people missed a toe or two, or even a finger. The landscape was very somber. There was only ice, as far as the eye could reach. Cliffs of ice, hills of ice, ground of ice. Ice everywhere. It was a landscape which you would quickly tire from, but these tribesmen knew nothing else. It was all they had ever seen. Only ice. They could only continue to walk. It had already been 2 days before any prey was found, but they were lucky. They had come upon a small group of woolly mammoths, but that was only the first of it. They still needed to kill one of them and bring it back, and that was easier said than done. Charging at a whole group of mammoths was suicide. They needed to find a relatively secluded one, preferably a small, weak one, then chase it into a trap. If they could separate them, it would be sublime. The group of tribesmen made sure to stay a good distance away from the mammoth herd as they made their plans. After they finished, about half of the group separated and went for a frozen hill in the distance. Skeg turned to his son and put his hand on his fur-covered shoulder.
"Remember, son, you just need to chase the mammoth with us. Don't get too close. When we manage to chase the mammoth to the others, you just stay back and throw your spears, all right? Remember, just stay back. This is only your first time. No need to show your bravery," Skeg said.
Ulfaldur looked at his father and nodded his head. He wouldn't go against the orders of his father, the chief. He knew that if he somehow managed to mess things up, then there was no way he could make up it. He knew that if he somehow managed to mess things up, then there was no way he could make it up. As the future chief, he had to be capable. And most of all, he had to not be stupid. As they finished talking, and the other group had made their way to the hill, the main group started sneaking towards the mammoths. Ooh, this one's looking really long. Okay, I think I can finish up this chapter. Oh man, maybe not, I don't know. It is pretty long. As they finished talking and the other group had made their way to the hill, the main group started sneaking towards the mammoths. The journey over took about 15 minutes as they tried to be sneaky. When finally there, they sat down to wait. They needed to wait for the best opportunity. They only had one shot at this. They would only be able to chase a single mammoth. Any more, and they'd be taking a workload beyond their capabilities. They wouldn't even be able to carry more than a single mammoth back home. The wait was very cold, and they could only lie still on the ground. They all felt the cold chill into their bones, and the temptation to rise and run was great. But they had to fight on. If they messed up, it was all over. If the mammoths ran away, it would be a pain to chase after them. Finally, after an hour of waiting, a single mammoth made a small distance. Made a small distance away from the herd? Finally, after an hour of waiting, a single mammoth made a small distance away from the herd. Their opportunity had finally showed itself. Skeg looked in the eyes of his son with a look that told him to prepare himself. Ulfaldur gulped as he rose up with the others. With a fierce cry, the group split in two once again.
Yee-haw!
They screamed as one group chased the lone mammoth, while the other chased the group, with the purpose of scaring them into retreat. However, they only chased a short distance until they regrouped with the main group. Now it was a game of chasing. They needed to chase the mammoth in a single direction while making all kinds of cries and screams. The men would go around it in a half circle and make sure that the mammoth could only go in a single direction. One of the few advantages humans had over the other animals was their endurance. They didn't possess great speed, nor strength, but they could run longer. They took great advantage of that fact and would try their best to tire down their prey. Chases would often last hours on end. As the mammoth tried to run to the side, the hunters would hurl their spears at them, lodging it deep inside it. This would make the mammoth turn direction again, except if they were really unlucky. This happened several times, and as they finally made it to the hill, the mammoth already had 5 spears lodged in its hide. As they neared the hill, the other group were naturally made aware of them from the loud screams. In a flash, they appeared from a boulder and hurled their spears at the mammoth, while a few others toppled the boulder, right towards the huge mammoth.
"Out of the way!"
Skeg shouted as the boulder came rolling down the hill. This was naturally a part of the plan, but he still made sure that everyone got out of harm's way. The ice boulder crashed into the side of the mammoth and shattered into pieces. As the mammoth collapsed and was sent a few meters... What? The ice boulder crashed into the side of the mammoth and shattered into pieces as the mammoth collapsed and was sent a few meters back. As the mammoth lay on its side, all the hunters shouted their war cries and lunged their spears into the mammoth until it breathed its last breath. Finally, they had felled the mammoth.
Yah!
They screamed in victory as they raised their spears. Naturally, Ulfaldr took part in this ritual as well. Then came the dreadful part. They needed to get this beast back home, and it was no easy task. The mammoth weighed several tons, and it would take a lot of effort. But the men could only clench their teeth and get to work. If they all worked together, it wouldn't be too hard. Luckily, they had brought some tools to help them. They were composed of large sticks made from bones, which they would tie the mammoth to. Then they would proceed to drag it home. It would be a long and arduous task, but in the end, it would be more than worth it. The mammoths were truly valuable to this people of the Ice Age. It contained both a lot of meat and fat, as well as its hide. It had the most fur of any animal. In this age, this small community was largely dependent on furs and fat, as well as bones. All their tools were made from bones, and all their clothes were made from furs. In this cold age, they needed warm clothes, or they would freeze to death. Then, as they had made their preparations, they finally began pulling. All of the men were helping, and the mammoth was slowly moving. It took about a week of arduous work before they finally made it back to their little village. As some child saw them creeping towards the village in the distance, he quickly notified everyone else. In but a moment, all the men and women stopped what they were doing and came out to wait.
"It's a mammoth! By the ass, they got a mammoth!"
Okay, apparently os, or is it os?
"By the os, they got a mammoth!"
I think os, it's spelled A-S-S, but apparently it means god or gods. It had been a long time since they last caught a mammoth, and it was great news for the tribe. Now they would have food for a long time, and wouldn't have to worry. The pregnant woman also had better chances for successfully bearing children. With a surplus of food and furs, the newborns would have a greater chance at surviving. It was very important for the tribe that the children survived. After all, there weren't that many people. The tribe only numbered about 30 people, and that was already quite a bit for the time. As the hunters finally made their way to the tribe, Rafarta came running towards them and put her son in a large embrace. She was truly proud of her son. For them to catch a mammoth on the first hunting trip of her son was truly an amazing thing to her. She had no doubt that the gods somehow favored Ulfaldr.
Ah, my dear Ulfkind, I'm so proud of you. I knew you would do well. I knew it. You must truly be favored by the us, for you all to catch a mammoth on your very first time. I knew it,
she exclaimed gladly as she held her son tightly. A few of the men looked at them with mocking grins. It wasn't that they actually mocked them. Everyone in the tribe was quite close, but the scene was quite humorous. The great warrior, apparently favored by the gods, was being hugged by his mother.
"Mother, please stop. You're embarrassing me,"
Ulfaldr said, with a red face. Not that he was that embarrassed, but his mother was quite strong, and he had a hard time breathing. He started to push himself away, but to no avail.
"What are you talking about? Can't a mother hug her son?"
she asked with a question mark. She asked with a question mark? What? Skeg shook his head and said,
"Rufarta, you should stop. Valdr is the next chief in line. He can't look weak in front of his peers and seniors. He must be strong, for the tribe, so stop treating him like a child. He's already an adult."
He looked towards his son and put his hand on the 15-year-old man's shoulder. These days, you were already an adult. You were already an adult by this age. After all, the life expectancy was quite low. You would be lucky to live for 40 years. After dragging the woolly mammoth back to camp, the work began. They had to skin it and slaughter it, then store the meat. Luckily, it was so cold that the meat would never rot, but instead freeze. They had dug a hole, using their rough bone tools, where they stored the meat. This way, the hole could act like an impromptu freezer. Not that they knew what a freezer was. Digging that hole had been quite the workload, since the ice was quite tough and hard. And the bad thing was that every time they had to migrate, they needed to make a new hole, if there wasn't something there functional at their new location already. After many hours of work, they had finally cut most of the hide off and stored the meat. Now, there was only a pile of bones left. They just let them stay in the corner where it wouldn't bother anymore. It wasn't as important to store the bones as it was the meat. The bones wouldn't attract any wild animals like the meat could. After all the work was finally finished, they had a small feast for the first time in several years. But it was only a small feast. They might be primal simpletons, but they still had survival instincts. They wouldn't splurge at the cost of their livelihood. Later, the over 24 tribesmen sat around their flickering campfire, munching on the brown, slightly black, meat in their hands. Everyone was festive and were enjoying themselves. They drank water, melted from frozen ice and snow, contained in bone cups and craniums. The men were singing their primal songs while the women danced. There were festive moods in the air, and everyone was affected.
"Valdr, my Mogr,"
which means young man, or boy, or son.
"Valdr, my Mogr, this is what it means to live in a tribe. This is what it means to live. We fight every day with the sole goal of survival. We are surrounded by enemies, be it the elements, wolves, or saber cats. Every day we fight, but that is what life is about. Don't you agree, Mogr? But it is on days like this that we truly live, when we come home to see the expectant faces of our kin and live up to those expectations. Today we have lived up to the hopes of all our kin. Don't forget, Ulfaldr. Never forget. When I once pass away, all this will be left to you."
Skeg said to his son, with a determined, albeit confident, expression. He had high hopes in his son. Maybe. He was like his mate, and truly believed that his son was blessed by the Os. But there was no such thing as being blessed by the Os. All that led to his success was luck. But all luck will eventually run out. And that's when everything went dark. Fierce winds blew over the campsite like a thundering mammoth and instantly extinguished the fire. Soon, everything was covered in a veil of white, and everyone found trouble seeing. A sudden snowstorm had struck. Okay, and that is the end of the first chapter. What was it again? The Eternal Chronicles, Vampire, by the Chronicler. Thanks for the request, Mr. Chronicler, sir. It seems like this one needs some work, man. You got probably 10 extra paragraphs worth of words here, like explaining things that don't need to be explained. And also, the commas
throwing me off constantly, so look up commas, look up how, I mean, there's like just a bunch of them in here that are just there for no reason, and just, it makes me, when I'm reading it, interpret the sentence completely differently than it should be. So, yeah, look that stuff up, and unfortunately we didn't get to any vampires in this chapter. So, if you want to make another request, maybe try a chapter that's not so long, or perhaps one with a few more characters. But thanks so much for requesting anyway. Maybe we'll see you again some other time. That was on Royal Road Legends, by the way, everybody. Eternal Chronicles Vampire by the Chronicler. So go check it out. I'll have links to all the books that I read from in the description of this stream after it's done. So if you want to find out where all this stuff is, you'll be able to look through there. All right, so I think we have two more requests today. What time is it? I've gone for 1:50, yeah. Two more, and I think we'll be good. Did all three of those, okay. So, surprise everybody. Well, this isn't so much a surprise. I think I posted it earlier. But we will be, where to go? Everybody loves large chests, everyone. He sent me another chapter. Man, I love doing these. They're so funny. And it's like thumbing its nose at all lit RPG too. Oh, I forgot to put up the lit RPG, Where'd it go? Come on, there it is. Bam. All right, and one more image. And I promise I won't leave it on this time. Gotta go get some more water.
Ooh, Lau.
All right. What's funny is Lau hates this show, especially Sundays, because 5 o'clock is supposed to be her feeding time. And so if I'm rushing around trying to prepare before the show, like, you know, every time, then I forget to feed her. She gets pissed. So I just fed her while I was getting, while I was getting water. Yeah. Jason called it. All right.
Ring, ring.
It would appear that Nagnamore could only maintain his physical form for about 2 minutes with the near 1,000 MP the mimic supplied during the possession ritual. Once that was up, he would crumble into dust and disappear.
Ring, ring!
That seemed to be the nature of how this particular ritual worked. The demon called forth from the beyond would have tremendous power, but his body would deteriorate rapidly after a short while. The other two offering type rituals the mimic knew about would probably behave the same way.
Ring ring!
Still, even if it was temporary, a high-ranking demon's servitude was simply a means to an end. Performing that particular ritual did wonders for the monster's demonology skill Performing that particular ritual did wonders for the monster's demonology skill proficiency, and it had plenty of troll blood left over, so it repeated the summoning a total of 3 more times until now.
Ring ring!
Zira seemed to want to complain vehemently about it each time, and even Korra was trying to get their master to stop performing it for some reason. As for Nagnamore, he was understandably the most pissed off of all... and complained the loudest. However, all of them were ignored completely as the stubborn box did whatever it wanted, as per usual.
Ring ring!
But the one thing that could not be ignored was that constant ringing noise inside the mimic's mind. It had been going on for the last hour or so, pretty much ever since the first time Nagnamore's physical body turned to dust. The familiars, Nagnamore included. Could be ordered to shut up easily enough, but that obviously wasn't going to work here.
Ring ring!
This was different from a simple sound. It was as if someone was poking at the monster's brain, trying to get its attention.
Ring ring!
Well, it didn't seem like it would just go away on its own, and even a creature of near infinite patience could only take so much damned ringing. Ugh, I screwed that up so bad. Well, it didn't seem like it would just go away on its own, and even a creature of near infinite patience could only take so much damned ringing. So it made the inevitable decision to answer it.
Ring ring!
Click.
Yes?
Okay, this is gonna be great.
Oh, finally!
Came the gruff, raspy voice from beyond. From the beyond.
Hey, buddy! It's Carl from Demons R Us!
This was the first time the organization known as Demons R Us had contacted the Mimic directly. Admittedly, this was only the third time the Mimic had spoken to them, but that was besides the point.
Hi, Carl,
it answered.
So, listen. I'm calling about the whole Overlord Nagnamore thing. We've been getting some trouble and complaints, and I need to get your side of the story. Do you mind if I ask you a few questions?
I'm busy.
I won't stop ringing until you answer me, by the way.
All right, I'm listening.
How exactly did you summon the Overlord into the physical realm?
I did the ritual.
Which one?
With the squiggles and the chanting and the stabbing.
You're going to have to be more specific.
Pretty much all demonic ritual involved at least one of those things. A lot of the time, it was all three at once.
It was the offering thingy.
So it was the offering to Nagnamore after all, huh?
Yes, that.
As per usual, a series of mechanical clicks could be heard over the cross-dimensional telepathic connection.
And how did you fulfill the pure maiden stabbed in the heart part of the ceremony?
I told Snack to do it.
I'm sorry, Snack?
Yes.
Who's that?
My familiar.
Which one?
The one with the hair and the legs.
Ah! The blue or red one?
Blue.
Okay, and how do you suppose a succubus qualifies as a pure maiden?
She's a female that wasn't poisoned or diseased. She was also clean. Before the blood, at least.
Oh, wow. Okay, it's starting to make sense now.
The thing about magic was that it relied heavily on the mind. Spells had a very precise formula to them, so different people would get very similar results when casting the same one. Rituals and such, however, were more free-form and could be easily influenced by one's perception and preconceptions. In other words, if the mimic who didn't know any better believed with all its might that Zira was pure, then she would be pure. At least as far as that ritual was concerned.
"Leave it to those fucking idiots to leave in a loophole like that," mumbled Carl under his breath. "Hmm? Oh, never mind that. What about the heart part?"
"Made snack grow one."
"Huh? But succubi shouldn't be able to change their insides to that degree."
"Yeah. Had to show her how to make one from her skin. Because she's stupid."
Wait. You ordered your familiar to grow a heart on the outside of her body?"
"Yes."
"Holy shit! I honestly have to say I'm impressed. I never would have even thought of that." "Okay. And what was your purpose in summoning Nagnamor in the first place?"
"I wanted skill proficiency for demonology."
"What, just that?"
"Yes."
"No kingdoms you wanted toppled or ancient beings of terrible power to suppress?"
"Nope."
"Hold, please."
Boop. An odd sound started playing inside the mimic's head. It wasn't like anything else the monster had ever heard before, but it was actually pretty pleasant. Ah, this must be that music thing it vaguely knew about. Who knew sound could be so tasty? It sat there enjoying the tune for about 5 minutes before Carl came back on the line.
Boop.
"I apologize for that. Can you send me your status, please?"
"Okay, sending."
I see you got a boxy tea morningwood. Pfft. Hold, please.
Boop.
Well, this was unlike Carl. Usually the demon was pretty quick and to the point about business. It's not like Boxy had anywhere to be, though, so it didn't particularly mind. The mimic was currently gathering up mana for the next ritual, and the music was pretty tasty anyway.
Boop.
Again, sorry about that, Mr. Morning... Morningwood.
Just Boxy's fine.
The mimic didn't particularly mind being called Mr. Morningwood, but Carl seemed unable to say it with a straight face for some reason. If he wasn't going to say the name properly, then he shouldn't be saying it at all.
"Right then. See here, Boxy. I'm gonna be straight with you. You can't summon Overlord Nagnamor using your demon as collateral anymore."
"Why not?"
"It violates part of the summoning contract. The one where you promised to safeguard your familiar's immortal souls against harm."
Come to think of it, Zira was talking about her ego being consumed by Nagnamor or something like that. The mimic didn't quite see how that was an issue, so it just kept doing what it wanted like usual.
"I know, you probably don't understand, so I'll clarify. Cramming two demons into the same physical vessel like that? Worst case scenario, both of them could get fragmented or malformed. That wasn't what you were trying to do, right?"
"No."
"Good, because that'd be bad."
"How bad?"
"We'd have to kill you."
"That's bad."
"Indeed."
"I understand. I'll stop using snack to summon Punchy."
"Punchy?"
"Yeah, the big one with the head and the arms. He punches himself real good," said Boxy with a hint of admiration.
"Uh-huh. So, listen, there's one more thing I need to talk to you about. I don't know what you made the Overlord do over there, and I have no intention of prying, but he's threatening to quit being an officer in the Demon King's army if he so much as smells you again. We want to avoid that, so we're prepared to offer you a deal."
"A deal?"
"Yeah, that's right. You have to agree that you never perform the offering to Nagnamor ever again, regardless of who or what your sacrifice is. In return, we'll provide you with a one-time boost of demonology proficiency up to level 5.
"Okay, I accept."
"All right. Hold, please."
Of course it agreed. Getting demonology levels was the whole reason Boxy was doing this whole thing in the first place, so getting what it wanted with less work was not a bad thing. Besides, it took a whole lot of time and preparation to summon Punchy, and it only lasted a few minutes. Even if the performance was excellent, his mileage was pretty bad.
There! All set! I've added our agreement to your summoning contract. You should be getting your compensation shortly.
Proficiency level increased. Demonology is now level 5. Wisdom, plus 4. Mental fortitude, plus 4.
I got it.
Okay, good. That's great. Whew! Hey, listen. Thanks for agreeing to that. I gotta say, it's so much easier working with you than my regular clients.
Really?
Yeah! You're uncomplicated and straightforward. It's a breath of fresh air compared to those edgy idiots I have to work with usually. Always with the stupid comments like, "You shall not pass," and "You have no power here." It's like those retards didn't even properly read the summoning contract.
Carl spent a few more minutes complaining about other warlocks. Boxy didn't particularly mind, since it was fairly interesting listening to him.
What I'm trying to say is, it's honestly a breath of fresh air working with someone like you. This whole thing would have been a laugh if it wasn't for the actual Demon King breathing down my neck. Anyway, sorry for that little rant. I've been under a lot of pressure lately.
It's all right.
Sighed Carl.
So, just so we're clear, do not ever use that ritual again. Okay?
Okay.
And don't use your familiars as sacrifices ever again, either. That's the important thing here. We wouldn't give a flying fuck if your regular... We wouldn't give a flying fuck if your rectangular ass died out there. But if a demon bites the big one because of your antics, then even killing you 100,000 times wouldn't be enough payback. Understood?
It was important to keep in mind that the summoning contract was indeed a partnership and not slavery. Generally, what happens to a demon's physical form didn't matter to an immortal being in the grand scheme of things, but endangering the integrity of their soul is another story. It was the one thing that must never, under any circumstances, be tampered with. If that clause was violated, then the warlock getting killed would just be the beginning of his punishment. What followed next would be... well, let's just say oblivion would be a much more preferable option.
You're lucky we caught this thing early. Another 10 or so more rituals and that succubus's soul would have suffered Another 10 or so more rituals and that succubus's soul would have suffered irreversible damage.
Carl, is my contract in danger?
No, you're fine. It's not like you were doing it on purpose. Besides, you cooperated readily and both of your familiars testified as to your, character. Therefore, the higher-ups have agreed to let you off with just a stern warning.
It would seem that all things said and done, Demons R Us were going to take Boxy's actions as a simple misunderstanding rather than malicious intent.
I see. Thanks, Carl.
Sure. Just try and avoid pissing off my boss anymore, yeah? Otherwise he might seriously terminate it.
How do I do that?
That's actually pretty easy. You just keep doing what you do, only without the two things we talked about just now. Like, for real, don't. And don't take so long to answer if we're the ones calling you. Okay?
Okay.
Good, good. Okay, bye.
Click. Well, that conversation was educational. Boxy nearly stepped on quite the landmine there due to its own ignorance, but it would seem things have more or less worked out.
All right, Snack. You can get down from there. Arms, untire.
Oh, thank fuck, said Zira. I really don't know how much longer I could take sharing a body with that insufferable asshole.
Hey, come on,
complained Cora while she untied the succubus from the stake.
Uncle Nagi isn't that bad.
Yes, he is. The whole reason he wanted a pure maiden in the first place is because... wait. Uncle? He's your kin?
Yeah, he's eldest of my dad's 49 siblings. I only met him once or twice, though.
Wow. That kind of makes things a lot worse.
What do you mean?
The first thing he had said... The first thing he thought he had...
The first thought he had when he saw you was how he'd like to, and I'm quoting his head here, split that fine ass on his dick.
Oh! That's pretty high praise coming from an archfiend.
It is?
Of course! Oi! Don't give me that disgusted look. It's a fiend thing, okay?
We're leaving now,
said Boxy, putting an end to their little agreement. Putting an end to their little argument.
There are things I need to get.
Even if they had left over troll blood, that one ritual was all the mimic was really equipped to do. They'd have to find components, not to mention sacrifices, to enact some of the other rituals. Of particular interest was a ceremony that was meant to call forth unholy wealth, whatever that was. However, they'd need quite a few things to pull that one off, not to mention that the monster still lacked knowledge about the warlock job in general. In other words, it was time to see about taking up residence inside a city.
Oh my god, that was so fun. So, Neven, Iliev, thank you so much for requesting another portion of your Everybody Loves Large Chests series. I guess, you know what, I just hope he just keeps requesting them. Or maybe he decides to release it on Amazon or something. I'm just having so much fun with this series. Oh, man. All right, so the very last request I'm doing today is indeed, it's a real surprise, actually, because I did not announce this at all to anybody. And the author has been kind of silent lately, except he actually is releasing this thing that I'm about to pop up. If I could just find it. Here it is. So, William D. Arand hasn't released a book in a while. Because he's been working on them. He's working on two different new series right now. Actually, he just completed another book. But that's going to be under a different name. And it's actually not... I don't even think it's lit RPG. I think it's just straight up erotica. Or maybe it is lit RPG erotica, I don't know. But he's releasing that under another name, so I didn't even tell you about that. That's not even real, what I just said. But he's still working on two other series. He's aiming to release, I think, the end of the summer? Midsummer, maybe? I don't remember. But I'm going to read something that he's already put together. It's the first chapter of one of his new series, and it's called the Anti-Hero Trilogy, I believe. And it's dark. It's much darker than than the other life series, the Selfless Hero Trilogy. And yeah, I just thought this would be a fun one to explore and give a little sneak peek with. Oh, by the way, that's right, like right in my face. Let me shrink that a little bit. It's uncomfortable. Ow. It's good yeast. He's releasing the omnibus of the entire series on Kindle. That's gonna be all three books in the Selfless Hero Trilogy packaged as one, and That's coming out, I think, February 1st, or at least the first week of February. So if any of you haven't read the books yet, or started it, the omnibus is going to be out. It's obviously much cheaper than buying all the books. And if you want the Audible versions, they're still going to be separate, because putting all the Audible books into one omnibus is not profitable for me at all. But for him, where he can actually control the price of the omnibus, it's a good deal. So if you're not big into audiobooks, or if you sometimes have time to read something rather than listen, I would say go look that up. The omnibus, the series is worth it, in my opinion. I really like the series. It's like a
I don't know, I feel like it's a lit RPG fable. A lot of people don't like the harem aspect. I think it was well done. I think it was balanced well enough. Especially when you get it, like, the second book kind of ties everything together. The first book kind of leaves you with a what is going on kind of feeling, but then once the second book comes around, it kind of makes, it kind of glosses over all the flaws of the first book and just kind of expands to a point where it's just like you're having fun watching this crazy journey. So I highly recommend The Other Life, the Selfless Hero trilogy, but this is new stuff and it's messed up. So William D. Aaron, a sneak peek into William D. Aaron's next series. Now, he didn't give me any real direction for the characters. There's only two characters here. But I'm going to make some assumptions just from the names. Chapter 1. End of the Beginning. End of the Beginning. Rene tilted his head to one side as the security guard crossed in front of him. He rested the rear sights on the back of the man's head. He wasn't much further than 10 yards away. The shot would be easy. Tracking the guard as he made his circuit, Rene had to fight against the inner impulse to pull the trigger.
Pull it, pull it, pull it. Drop the hammer, feel the boom, watch the blood, paint the room, spray and splatter. Foreplay and gray matter.
Grinding his teeth silently, Rene eased his finger off the trigger and onto the trigger guard. His inner demon demanded its payment. Rene denied it. It'd receive its due soon enough. Until then, it'd have to deal with it. Easing out of the darkened corner he'd been hiding in, Rene flitted across the grass and into an adjoining courtyard. Silent as a caress, Rene glided to a far side door and listened for a moment. The soft hum of electricity beyond the door was all he could discern. Opening the door smoothly, as if he were nothing out of the ordinary, Rene stepped into the room. Oh, as if it were nothing out of the ordinary. Confidence often would disorient people long enough to subdue anyone nearby. A door opened swiftly or slowly was more likely to alert someone.
Kill them. Spill them. Drain them dry.
The voice had become a soft mutter in the back of his head for the moment. As of late, though it had grown louder than he could ever remember previously, when his emotion... What? As of late, though, it had grown louder than he could ever remember previously when his emotions ran high. Time was catching up with him. His body had started to slow down a few years ago, and now his mind was starting to slip. His steel-reinforced control was slowly eroding with each and every day. A sad and final realization was forming in the dark moments late at night. He would lose control of himself before he actually managed to get himself killed on a contract. He would lose control of himself before he actually managed to get himself killed on a contract. Lose control and go on a rampage and have to be put down like a crazed animal.
Crazed? No, no, no. Animal? Yes. Beast we are, Rene. At least, so far for today.
It only took a single moment to realize the room was empty. Rene had a sense for these kind of things. Trained to what some people would call ESP, he was confident in his senses. Closing the door behind himself, he dismissed the interior with a thought. The room's decorations didn't matter a whit to him. Pressing a gloved hand to the switch, he slid it into the off position and moved deeper into the manor. His target was a man only a year older than Rene himself.
The 43-year-old had fled to Mexico with his secretary. The 43-year-old had fled to Mexico with his secretary, along with all the money in the joint account he shared with his wife of 20 years. His wife had paid the bill after selling a few things, and Renee had taken the job. It was beneath him, but it would pay the bill. But it would pay the bills. I guess. Sorry, it's not finished, so he hasn't done any editing. The butcher's bill on his soul was coming soon past due. A murderer by trade, he at least made sure to never kill outside of a contract.
Time to pay. We collect today. A feast for me, a priest for he.
As the guttural voice stopped, Renee looked up around. A spiral staircase.
No more rhyming tonight, or I'll make you wait,
Renee whispered to himself.
Please forgive. We jest, we kid. A game it was. Heaven forbid.
Renee thumbed the safety on his pistol, contemplating leaving the house entirely and refunding the woman her money.
Fine! As you will it.
Moving up the stairs without a sound, Renee kept himself ready. There had been little information the wife could provide him with other than an address. Worse, he had no time to prepare, as the little monster that sat behind his eyes would only allow him free rein for so long. Then he heard a sound that he often heard on contracts like this. Soft, rhythmic bed creaking, and the sound of flesh hitting flesh. It came from somewhere ahead of him, in what he could only assume was a bedroom.
Well, he took his secretary, so yeah. Better make it worthwhile. I mean, did you see the picture of her? Damn, you should hire a secretary.
Renee could only agree. He was a sociopath, sure, but he still enjoyed women. And sex. Slipping his pistol into the holster under his dark clothing, Renee pressed to a wall and crept along it. Baseboards could and would creak. In his personal experience, walls tended to have less of this problem. Not always, but less. He'd have to wait until they finished and make it clean. He'd been paid for the husband, not the entertainment.
Why not both? Might as well. Two for one, both to hell.
Renee ignored it. He'd been doing that his whole life. After the husband was done and bled dry, the voice would leave him be. Renee only had to wait for them to separate or sleep. Finding the door he wanted by sound alone, Renee put his back to the wall to wait for a bit.
Old guy like this won't take long. Not like you'd know. You got laid, what, 6 months ago? I think I'd forget what a woman felt like at that point. That, or his secretary, will get bored.
Renee flexed his muscles slowly as he settled into position. His knees had an ache in winter that he couldn't quite get rid of. It was a shame his monster needed regular payments, otherwise he'd take the entire winter and fall off. Long gone were the days of running around in the government employ. Though he carried around the cashed checks his body had written for that period in his life. No sooner than he got comfortable than he heard a groan from beyond the door and the soft thump of a body falling into the sheets. A higher-pitched voice asked a question in a complaining tone. The man responded with a murmur, and there was no further discussion.
Minuteman, can you come any faster?
5 minutes after that, and Renee felt safe enough to work the unlocked door open. Letting his eyes take stock of the room, he left the door ajar. A rapid exit was worth more than the security a closed, flimsy door would provide. Laying asleep on the left side of the bed was a beautiful woman of perhaps 20, nude and only partially covered in the sheets. Beside her was the overweight husband. Renee ignored all other details beyond that. It wouldn't do him any good, and would only prove to be a problem later on. Reaching into a pouch on his side, he lifted out a dark black case. Gently opening it, he retrieved the preloaded hypodermic syringe inside. Removing the tip on the needle, he repositioned himself. Holding his hand above the woman's mouth, he guided the needle up under the carotid artery of her throat. If he did it right, she'd be out in seconds of the injection.
Kill, 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 kill! Kill her now!
Feeling his mind shudder under the desire. Feeling his mind shudder under the desire and need to jam the needle into her eye and into her brain, Renee stood still. Battling internally with the monster that he was, he fought to preserve her life against his own desires. She didn't deserve to die for sleeping with a married man, one who would drop her as soon as she lost her youth. Instead of winning the battle with himself, it felt like he was starting to lose. Pressing his hand down against the woman's mouth and nose, he jabbed the needle in. It didn't feel as precise as he wanted it to be, but it felt like the right spot. Depressing the plunger with his thumb as soon as it entered her, the needle filled her with strong sedatives. Her eyes flicked open, met his, then glazed over after a few seconds, then closed once more, and she was dead to the world. She'd be unconscious till morning, but alive. Removing the needle with a shaking hand, he recapped it and slipped it back into the case. Then put the case in his pouch.
Now mine, me, feast, blood, take, take, take!
Unable to contain himself any further, he put a knee on the woman's stomach, his left hand on her bare chest, and leaned her over. And leaned over her. In his right hand, he unclipped his Glocka B1, flipped it open, and buried it in the man's throat. Savagely ripping the blade from one side to the other, Renee felt his own eyes go wide and his body shudder at the sudden act. Blood pumped in an arterial spray timed to the man's heartbeat. Lifting his hand, Renee slammed the blade home into the man's larynx and dragged it down across the side. It was done, but not over. Lifting his leg up, he brought his knee down into the unconscious woman's shoulder as he slapped his left hand to the dying man's head, even as he started to thrash about. Crashing the hilt of the blade into the temple of the dead man who wasn't quite done dying, Renee grunted. When he didn't fall still with the first hit, he struck him again. Dropping back into the bed, the man moved no more, even as his blood sprayed across the room with every beat of his heart. Panting, Renee crawled off the woman.
Sorry,
he said lamely to the woman he'd manhandled. Feeling the release of pressure as the air in the room picked up the sweet smell of blood, Renee closed his eyes. He enjoyed it. He knew it was wrong. Knew he'd just killed a man for money. And enjoyed it. He didn't care. He felt more remorse for bruising the woman than killing the man. More remorse for the poor fool who'd be paid less than $10 to clean up this mess. Wiping his blade off on the sheets, he folded it back up and slipped it into its holster. Turning from the scene, Renee exited the room and closed the door behind him. In a minute, he'd made it back to the garden corner that had been his hiding place earlier. Once the guard passed him again, he'd be off. Back to his dingy hotel room. Then, a plane ride back to a house he hired someone to decorate and clean. To sleep in a bed that was too large for him by a family of four. Maybe buy a prostitute, read a book, play a video game. Then kill someone again. Paralysis struck him. His entire body seizing up and beyond his control. His mind started to claw at his muscles, demanding them to move as a light began to build around him. Then the faint light became a blazing spotlight all at once. Illuminated like a beacon, it wouldn't be long before someone spotted him.
What the fuck?
Renee ground out between clenched teeth. Then the guard was there, a pistol raised in Renee's direction. The guard shouted something at him. He couldn't quite make it out, as the light was actually putting out a lot of noise as well. Not loud enough to drown out the sound of the single gunshot, though. Rene felt the large caliber round burst through his chest and blow out the back of his spine. The light around him flickered then, becoming something else. Somewhere else. He was standing in a room of interlocking stones and at the center of a blazing purple circle. Around him stood men and women in rich robes. Torches dotted the walls and gave the room a creepy, old-timey feel. Then Rene was free to move. At which point, he promptly fell flat on his face and died. All right, so that's where I'm going to leave it for today. There is more to this first chapter, but I'll let you guys speculate on what it is. So thanks everybody for showing up to my stream. remember, if you want to support the stream, I have tons of audiobooks. I have 61 right now. That's 61 on Audible right now. There's more on the way. The feedback loop is on its way. It's with the gnomes as we speak. So I think it got sent off Friday. It got sent off Friday. I messed up on Thursday and didn't upload properly. So we had to wait till Friday for ACX to give us back control so we could make the change. But it is out. It is on its way. It's been 2 days, I guess. So I'm predicting either this coming Friday or the next Monday, feedback loop will be out. And I'm really excited for it. Keep an eye out. I'll be giving out audiobooks from now on my Wednesday streams. I'm going to be giving out 5 audiobooks every time. So don't forget to come to my upcoming Wednesday, because I will be reading from Stone Cold Bastards. Jake Bible has hired me to do this one, and I'm really excited because I've been wanting to work with him for a while. He does really well on the Kindle market. I'm sure some of you have heard of him by now. But this one is an urban fantasy about gargoyles. So I'm psyched for it. It's weird and dirty and gritty and fun, most of all. So yeah, please come to Soundbooth Theater Live at 7 p.m. on Wednesday. That's February 1st. And if for any of you who didn't know this, for those of you who have watched the stream a lot, especially my Wednesday and Thursday shows, where I actually do the books that I've been hired for instead of just requests, I used to just record while I was doing that, really I was just doing what I usually do with the stream happening while I do it. But I've discovered that makes the show kind of slower, right? Because I have to edit, like I'm editing too much, you know, and every time I make a mistake, I can't just keep going like I do here. Sometimes I mess up here on Request Only so bad, I'm like, fuck, I gotta redo it so that people actually understand what I'm saying. But when it's just like a word that I mess up and I can just keep going, that makes the stream go by a lot smoother. It makes it more watchable. And also, it gives me like this, it gives me a trial run. It gives me a warm-up so that I've already gotten practice narrating this particular thing, and I got a head start, I got the feel, and I can just start over and start already warmed up as far as recording goes. And also, I can take chapters out of sequence. I don't have to go chapter by chapter from the very beginning to just like the first 20%, because sometimes there's really cool scenes from books that I wish that I had done for the stream, but didn't, because it just wasn't far enough into the book. So yeah, it's going to be Wednesday, and I'm not even doing a Thursday anymore. It's just, I'm only going to be doing Wednesday shows and Sunday shows, because again, now that I don't have to record, I don't have to do 2 shows to make up for the fact that there's less content. You know, I can spread the content out to several different chapters
and just do several different scenes that are interesting and just leave it to that one day. So I think this is a good way to streamline the stream and make it a more fun experience. But yeah, please come hang out Wednesday, 7 p.m. Central, obviously Central Time. And yeah, I'll be reading from Jake Bible's Stone Cold Bastards. And don't forget about... where to go? Other Life Dreams, Other Life Nightmares, Other Life Awakenings, the Selfless Hero Trilogy from the author of that I just read the last request, William D. Arand. Paragons just came out. It's been out for not even a week now. So go check that out. It's already getting good ratings. People are enjoying it. I'm glad. So if you haven't listened to that already, it's available. I am working on Secret of the Old Ones right now. That will be out in the next few weeks. That's and of course Blaze's other book, Delvers LLC, is already out on Audible. So go pick that up. That one is blowing up. Already 100, probably 180 ratings by now, and it's only been out for like 2 weeks. So people are going nuts for it. Go check it out. And thanks so much. Thanks so much for coming and hanging out with me on Soundbooth Theater Live. You guys are great, as always. Thank you for all the requests from everybody who sent requests. I hope you keep sending them. Join the Facebook group. Discuss things. You know, maybe have conversations with each other about what you'd like to see on the stream. Because that's what the Facebook thing is there for. So you guys can talk about how the stream could be made better. And also, you know, I have the Twitch channel. If you're watching on Facebook, if you're watching on YouTube, or yeah, if you're watching on Facebook, there's the Twitch channel. If you want to hang out with everybody else who's regulars and talk, and there's also YouTube. If Facebook is too much of a pain in the ass and Twitch is too much of a pain in the ass, I still stream to YouTube. So you can go to my YouTube channel, user/fiatmedia. And I think that's it. I think that's all the pitching I'm going to do. So thank you guys so much, and I will see you again Wednesday.